Where are we?
Oh, we're over there now.
Okay.
It's my utmost, first highest.
At least I think it is. I hope it is.
I think it is. You know, some days, like today, it's just a little harder to do the normal things that you think that you ought to do or that you want to do. For me, I have challenges both in health and sometimes just in knowing to not go too far with what my abilities are, because I always want to do more and I always want to accomplish more than what I really can. And sometimes God allows me to go through some real shoom. What's that mean? Well, that's an interpretation. No, what that is really is just simply suffering. You know, it's just one of those things that, you know, your shoulder will ache, or your body will ache, or you'll have a sinus thing, and you'll have a neck stiffness, and you'll have just all kinds of things going, what feels like, wrong, and you think, oh, I'm getting older, I'm this, that, or the other thing, and I can't move. And the reality is, maybe God wants to slow you down, you know? Sometimes that's what he does. Not because he's doing it to you, but because while you've been under grace for so long that God has given you the strength and ability to accomplish all the things that you've done up to this point, when he pulls back his grace, he allows just the normal consequences of your body, flesh, to be aware of and knowledgeable of. And then suddenly I know that with me, because of my body, that God sustains me, that, man, when it kicks in, it's like, oh, you know, I'm dying. It's like, oh, man. And you just want to, you know, crawl into bed and hide, or you want to crawl into a jacuzzi, you know, and bubble it away, or you want to do something, but in any way, you know, you just don't necessarily always like, you know, what you might be going through, because sometimes it's tough to be a Christian. Sometimes it's hard to walk with God. God never said it'd always be easy. He even said it might cost your life, but he promised that he'd be with us, and so that's why we spend the time to take the time to be with him in the morning or in the noon or at night, to find out, you know, is there anything that you want us to change, Lord, or is it just me kind of going through one of those owie times, oh, ow, 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 and I'm not feeling Mr. Happy, or am I? My utmost for his highest. The sacrament of sacrifice. He that believeth in me, out of him shall flow. John 7:38. Jesus did not say, he that believeth in me shall realize the blessing of the fullness of God. But he that believeth in me, out of him shall escape everything he receives. Our Lord's teaching is always anti-self-realization. You know, just to make a point here too, nobody ever said you have to love yourself first in order to love others. That is the biggest lie I've ever heard in the world. Jesus never said to love yourself and then love others, or that you have to love yourself in order to love God. You can love others first, and then because God loves you, you'll love yourself. Besides, loving yourself is an unhealthy place to be. I would rather love me through what God has given me in his love than to love me with my love. Because then it gets pretty, like, selfish, self-centered, and becomes all about me, me, and I, we, us, them, whatever. But the point is, no, don't get caught in that lie. Don't think that your self-esteem is tied up with your self-love. That's baloney. Your self-esteem is determined by what you esteem to be as important to who you are. And who died for you is Jesus Christ. And if God so loved the world and so loves you that he gave his only begotten son, then your self-esteem is based upon the fact that God loves you, not the fact that you feel like you're somebody important. So dump the self-esteem. It has nothing to do with Christianity. Self-esteem has to do with what God esteems you to be. And God created you, God made you, God died for you, God lives for you, God changes you, God makes you, God's rearranging you, God's creating in you, and causing you to become a son of God. And because he loves you so much, he's doing it for you and in you and accomplishing it through you. So don't get caught up in the stupid idea of I have to love me and have a right self-esteem. You have to have a God esteem, and then everything else falls into place. Sometimes I get on my soapbox. Our Lord's teaching is always anti-self-realization. Our purpose is not the development of a man. His purpose is to make a man exactly like himself. And the characteristics of the Son of God is self-expenditure. If we believe in Jesus, it is not what we gain, but what he pours through us that counts. Through us, not to us. It's supposed to come in and go out, not stay inside, and then we take it for granted that we have it and it's ours and we possess it and then make ourselves into something we're not. It is not that God makes us beautifully rounded grapes, but that he squeezes the sweetness out of us. Spiritually, we cannot measure our life by success, but only what God pours through us, and we cannot measure that at all. When Mary of Bethany broke the box of precious ointment and poured it on Jesus' head, it was an act for which no one else saw any occasion. The disciples said it was a waste. But Jesus commended Mary for her extravagant act of devotion and said that wherever his gospel was preached, this also that she had done shall be spoken of it for a memorial of her. Our Lord is carried beyond himself with joy when he sees any of us doing what Mary did. Not being set on this or that economy or money, but being abandoned to him. To just do at the moment what it is that brings great joy to Jesus in the love that you're expressing to him as you express it the way you are. God split the life of his Son that the world might be saved. As we prepare to spill our lives out for him? He that believeth in me, out of him shall flow rivers of living water. Hundreds of other lives will be continually refreshed. It is time now to break the life, to cease craving for satisfaction, and to spill the thing out. Our Lord is asking of us, who will do it for him? In other words, if all that you're doing is for yourself, and all you're accomplishing is your ministry, and all you're doing is getting something that makes you feel good, then you're missing the point of why God is working through you to touch other people's lives. Because you are an effect, whether you know it or not, to everyone around you. And that effect will either be a vessel of wrath or a vessel of honor. It will be a vessel that God uses for his own purposes. So he is accomplishing, irregardless of what you do, say, think, feel, or experience, his own purpose, no matter what. But you can participate with him in it, in that you are becoming changed into the image of his Son by what he's doing in you to accomplish that purpose by the circumstances of your life, forcing you to come to him to seek his wisdom, to be taught by him, so that God would place in your heart his word, so you would know him and hear his voice and walk according to his way and not your own, so that you wouldn't do what you want to do, but you would do what he wants you to accomplish through him and by him and for him as he works in you to go to others to bring them to himself. Kind of leaves you out of the picture in a way, because you're not his hands and feet. I'm sorry, and you're not his mouthpiece. God can work just perfectly fine without my hands, my feet, my mouth, or my nose. So don't get carried away. Just get carried in God, away to what he wants for you today.